as we've been walking through the first 2 weeks, we've been talking really about what does the Bible say about sinners? What does the Bible say about homosexuality? Tonight we want to talk about what does the Bible say about this issue of transgender, because it's become a very big thing. I mean, there are two books here that I want to recommend before I go any further. They're both very recent books. You've got them right on the top of your page. When Harry Became Sally is a very recent book that deals with the topic more on a cultural level, okay? So this is more of a cultural kind of book. It is written from a Christian perspective, but it's talking about it more in the sense of the culture at whole. Where did this topic come from? What's the science behind it? What's the sociology behind it? What's the psychology behind it? And it's a biblical point of view, but it's tackling it more at a 30,000 foot view. The other one is God and the Transgender Debate. And while he does some of that cultural stuff, it's really more written from a pastoral point of view. So I think both together are helpful books. If this is a topic specifically that impacts you, you might want to get one or both. If you only have the time to get one, I'd say get the second one. If you're looking at it more from a slightly more distant view, maybe get the first. But if you're able to get both and you're up for about 500 pages of reading, they would both be helpful. So you are probably a lot like me, and this topic has really come a long way in a relatively short period of time for those of us that are, say, 30 and up. I can remember my first experience with this might be what yours was as well, and that was the character on MASH. Do you remember? I can't remember the guy's name, but he was continually cross-dressing, though if I recall correctly, it was more implied that he was doing so to try to get sent home. But that was my first experience of it. And then I remember back in the late 80s, early 90s, an entertainer, I think he's still on some cable channel, a guy named RuPaul. You remember him? Okay, he was more of the drag queen style of transvestite, if I can call it that. Much more recently, maybe the first person that came out on cable as a transgender person, at least the first that I can remember, was the daughter of Sonny and Cher. Her name was Chaz. I think she changed her name too when she transitioned to being a man, Chaz Bono. And of course, Caitlyn Jenner. When Bruce Jenner became Caitlyn Jenner, then it really became mainstream. This became something that everyone was talking about, and that's just a handful of years ago. And of course, from Bradley Manning, who's now Chelsea Manning, and the government has ruled that the government has a responsibility to provide, even though this man was for a period of time in jail, to provide for his transitional hormones and that kind of thing to help him. That was a required thing. To the Amazon show that lasted until the star got himself into some trouble, called Transparent, which really put this on the map in a popular sense of a transgender person presented in a way that Hollywood would really get behind in a family comedy of that kind of thing. To more recently, there being this issue in North Carolina where a number of states, New York included, have banned the travel of government employees to the state of North Carolina because North Carolina passed a bill saying that you had to go into the bathroom that was in accordance with your birth gender. Your sex at birth determined which bathroom you went into. And so that became a big topic of discussion in our culture. In fact, just this past week while we were away, there was an article in the Times Union. I was reading the Times Union online, and I just happened by it. I was not searching for it. But there was an article on the 4th of this month. So today is the 6th, 2 days ago. The headline was, Drag Queen Storytelling Event for Kids at Albany Public Library. And the interesting thing to this was, we were in Vineyard Haven, Massachusetts, and we were going through their local newspaper of things, and the exact same event was happening at their public library that very same, well, the week before that. And I just take this from the Times Union article about this. I'm quoting it directly. It says, Drag Queen Story Hour is a nonprofit that hosts storytelling events worldwide. The goal, organizers say, is to capture the imagination and play of gender fluidity during childhood and give kids glamorous, positive, and unabashedly queer role models. In spaces like this, kids are able to see people who defy rigid gender restrictions and imagine a world where people can present as they wish and where dress up is real. So that was just in 2 days ago, the Albany Times Union. So what I want to talk about tonight, and we're only going to spend about half of our time on this topic, not because it's not a big topic, but because there's no way we're going to be able to tackle it all, and so much of it fits into the overarching. I just want to take this opportunity and deal with it independently. But we want to first start with, what is gender anyway? Okay, and you've got some of this for you there on the handout. There might be other things you want to write down as we go, but there's not any blanks per se to fill in. I wanted to make sure that you got it. But what is gender? Well, there's what gender has been understood to be up until, say, the last, maybe the last century, certainly the last 40, 50 years. This has been challenged, but traditionally, gender has been seen to be the social manifestation of one's biological sex. Okay? So what I mean by that is, people would say, biologically I am male, and so my gender is also male, and there are ways that males act in a culture that would correspond in some ways to that biological nature. Okay? Biologically, genetically, there are differences between male and female, differences in our body, and these are not happenstance. These are for a purpose we're going to see tonight, okay? But that you would look at yourself biologically as a man and say, and it's not a rigid, and one of the things we're going to talk about is that we don't want to over-define some cultural ideas of what a man or a woman is supposed to be, but we do want to say that there is a spectrum of things that we might identify and say, this is how a male behaves, this is his function in society, this is how a woman behaves. There are biological differences that set how a woman behaves within a spectrum of possibilities. We don't want to say that a woman has to look like June Cleaver or has to look like something that's set on TV today, all of these norms, but within a spectrum, and that it is connected, and this is the important point, that it is connected to one's biological sex, that the biological differences inherent in a man's body and a woman's body dictate within a realm how that person should act in that culture, okay? So traditionally, that's what gender has meant. Now, if you fast forward, especially to the last 15, 20, 30 years, gender has come to mean something else entirely. Gender in among these people, here we are living in a day. I know we all kind of roll our eyes since the 90s anytime a pastor talks about postmodernism, and some of you are like, what does that even mean? It's a view that truth is disconnected from reality, that truth exists inside the mind of the person who's arriving at it. And so truth is not something that exists externally. There might be many truths, right? And that's the world that we live in. And because of that, people would say today, well, gender is not connected to one's biology. That gender is divorced from sex. And I mean by that your sex, male, female. That gender is divorced from that. That gender describes what a person identifies as internally. So in the past, you would say, I'm a man because I have a man's body, okay? Or you're a woman because you have a woman's body. That's how you were born. It's what you have. Today, they would say that gender is how you feel about yourself. Do you identify? Do you think of yourself as being a woman, or do you think of yourself as being a man? Now, once upon a time, until fairly recently, that was called gender dysphoria, because it was a clinical term that defined a mental problem where mentally a person was separated from the reality of their body, okay? So it was called gender dysphoria, and this question has come up a few times. Some of you have written them in, is this really something that a person believes, or is it just how they act? I'm inclined to believe this person when they say that they feel, this man feels that he's a woman, or that woman feels that she's a man. I know that there might be some instances where a person wants to identify with a loving community that exists outside of frameworks, but I still think, even with those people, that there is a large percentage of it that is internally they do feel disconnected from what their body says that they are. I don't think that many people that I've talked to that struggle in this area, that it's just something that they've just made up because they just want to go down this road. So I think it's a genuine feeling that they have. So it's a deeply held sense that who you are is at odds with your biological self. And so when we talk about transgenderism, that's what we're talking about. We're talking about anyone who feels that their gender, as it's defined today, as being that internal sense of self, is the opposite of one's biological self. So transgender might be somebody that's going through sex change hormones and through genetic, it used to be called genetic reassignment surgery, now it's called genetic confirmation surgery, which tells you something. But maybe they're going through that, or maybe they're just someone who's saying, I am a woman trapped inside a man's body. So when we talk about transgender, we're really talking about nothing more than that. Now, while transgender people have always existed, it seems, from what we can see, their sense of self has been treated until very recently as a condition of the mind rather than a condition of the body, okay? So up until now, while it's been identified for as long as we can look back, societies have said this is something where we need to treat the mind, not the body. Now, certain scientific advancements and certain different things and studies and medicine have made it so that somebody can take hormone therapy so that a man's voice might not be so low, so that he might start to develop breasts and he might look less like a man, or that a woman might be able to be changed through that hormone therapy in what she does. And there are surgeries that one can have. But the important point to realize is, if we look at this biologically, guess what happens as soon as those hormone therapies are no longer taken? The person, of course, reverts back to what they are by their DNA. They revert back to how they were created. We can go in and surgically change the way that a man or a woman looks to mimic that of the opposite sex, but we cannot actually make a man a woman, because at their very base level of how they were created, that person was created with the male sex or the female sex. And so what I want us to do as we talk about all of these things, we want to speak the truth in love. And it's not a loving thing, as we've said a few times, it is not the loving thing to encourage a person down the road that God says leads to death and destruction. We want to speak the truth in love to these people as we confront these things. So just a few facts, all right? Just a few facts. One of the questions I got was, do we know what percentage of the population we're looking at here? The estimates range from somewhere between 0.1% to, on the high side, 0.4% of Americans that identify as transgender. Okay? So on the high side, we're talking about 1.4 million Americans who would identify as transgender, to potentially 1/4 of that, okay? So somewhere in that range is who we're talking about. Now, one of the questions that I have gotten a few times over the year, in fact, when I was a very new pastor, there was a family with a young son. This is not anyone connected here, but there was a family of a young son that was struggling with a son who was wanting to dress up in female ways and was wanting to play with what was identified as female toys. And there was the concern about, what does this say? And I remember calling my counseling professor in seminary was a trained psychiatrist before he became a biblical counselor. He said that the reason he did that is because he felt all he was doing was air conditioning people's ride to hell. And the gospel talked about not just coping, but liberation, right? But what he said was, he said, tell them not to freak out. Tell them just to pray and love and talk to that boy. Part of the reason why, and the wisdom behind it, is 80 to 95%, all right? 80 to 95% studies have shown of children who express some level of gender dysphoria, a boy who feels like he's a girl or a girl who feels like she's a boy, 80 to 95% of them, by the time they have grown up, they will have settled themselves on their natural, by birth given sex. So 80 to 95% of the time, just time settles these things, just as a child. Now, part of the reason why this is so important is because there are many activists in the LGBT community who are advancing the idea that parents have a responsibility to affirm a child at very young ages. I've read about children at the ages of 5 and 6 being encouraged to begin these hormone therapies because they have identified themselves as the opposite sex. In fact, and I'm jumping all the way down here to the bottom one, the Human Rights Campaign, which is an LGBT activist organization. The Human Rights Campaign, on their website, there's an FAQ section. They caution parents of children whose children express some sense of transgender issues. They caution them against encouraging their children to put off hormone therapy and gender reassignment surgery or identifying themselves in a public way as the opposite sex. They encourage them to put that off because of the fear of encouraging your child towards emotional damage. The implication being that by your discouraging them to express themselves in this way, you might actually be encouraging them to commit suicide. You might be encouraging them to struggle with this in a way that if you're just affirming of what they're going through, then you'll be a better parent. So let me jump back to the third point. Transitioning has not been shown. Okay, so by transitioning, we mean everything from identifying as the sex that they feel that they are, to undergoing hormone therapy, to undergoing sex reassignment surgery. Transitioning has not been shown in any study to improve that person's psychological state. In fact, the people who have transitioned, okay, are 19 times more likely to attempt suicide than the rest of the population. 19 times more likely. These are the people that have gone in that direction of affirming this inner sense that they have. 19 times more likely than anyone else to attempt suicide. So that's why it's important for us to talk about these things. None of these things should shock us, right? There's a couple of reasons that none of these things should shock us. I wanted us to start out with that praying so that we're not looking at transgender people or gay people as them over there. These are people that we love, right? These are people that we care about. These are people that we want God's best in their life because we do. But none of these things should shock us for a couple of reasons. Number one, we live in a fallen world, okay? We live in a Genesis 3 world. We will until Jesus comes back again. From Genesis 3 to Revelation 19, all right? And if you're new to the Bible, it's the first book and the last book, all right? From Genesis 3 to Revelation 19, we are living in this world where we are all born into sin. We are living in the reality of that. And the sin goes right down to our very sense of who we are. Paul talks about his inner man battling against his flesh, right? That part of you that's been renewed by the gospel battling against that part of you that's just your fallen, sinful person. We all understand that struggle. It just comes out of us. So for us to say that maybe 4/10 of our population, 0.4% of our population struggles in this area should not surprise us. Nor, if we understand this biblically, should we conclude that God created them this way. We're going to talk more about this, all right? But nor should we conclude that God created them this way. And we'll get there. But the other reason, when we talk about these things like 19 times higher risk of suicide, and by the way, let me just say this. Back in 2006, 2008, I think it was 2006, when the Obama administration was passing laws that required health insurance companies to pay for gender reassignment surgeries. At the same time, his own health organization within the government, the name's slipping my mind right now, was releasing a study that was basically saying the exact opposite, that there was no evidence to support the fact that gender reassignment surgeries helped anyone's psychological state. So at the same time he's demanding that insurance companies pay for it, the federal government itself is saying that there's no psychological benefit that's been demonstrated to this. But we shouldn't be surprised by that because, as we've said so many times, when we choose to sin, we choose to suffer. And part of the reason why we want to speak the truth in love is obviously because we believe that a holy God exists. We believe that hell is a real place. That every single one of us, because we willingly rebel against God, deserves to go there. But we also know that in this life, right here and now, there are consequences of sin that affect all of us. And not only do we not want them or anyone else to experience hell, we also want them to be able to walk in the joy of being in the will of God for their life. Because when we follow God's will for our life, that is the clearest path to our joy. And so for both of those reasons, we want to deal with this. Now, what does the Bible have to say about gender? The answer is an awful lot and not an awful lot at the same time in two different senses. Okay? Probably 2 years ago, maybe 3 years ago, the years blend together. I spent a long time preaching through the first three chapters of Genesis because they're so foundational. The whole Bible is wrapped up in the first three chapters of Genesis. So when I say not a lot, there aren't a lot of passages in the Bible that are going to deal with this. But when I say a lot, what I mean is it's dealt with in the very most foundational passage in the Bible that talks about who we are and what we were created to be. We've already seen it at least once. So what does the Bible have to say about gender? You've got it there, Genesis 1, 26 through 28. And we're going to see four things from this. But Genesis 1, 26 through 28, it says, "Then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves on the earth." Now, here's four things, all right? And we're going to try to unpack them as we walk through just a little bit. But four things that I want you to see from these four verses, 26, three verses, all right? Number one, definitions of male and female are not cultural. When we look at the Bible, he says to us right from this foundational moment that he creates male and female. They're not cultural, but assigned by the Creator. Okay? So when David says that you knit me together in my mother's womb, we're not just talking here about Adam and Eve. We're talking about everyone. Now, this is an argument that's often advanced. They'll say, what about people that are born, I don't know if people still use this term, so forgive me if it's out of vogue, hermaphrodite, where somebody is born with less than determinate identity. Perhaps they have two different partially developed sex organs. They may have fully developed. There's a whole range of situations that you might have there where a person's assigned sex at birth is not as clear as it is at all times. And we want to deal with this honestly. The statistic is in about one out of every 5,000 births, they're somewhere on that scale. One out of 5,000, okay? They're somewhere on that scale. But in the vast majority of those, one sex, we're here we're talking biologically, is obviously more prominent than the other, okay? In very few cases, is there not one sex that's really prominent. But you might be saying, or somebody watching this might be saying, okay, so, but even if there's just one situation, then doesn't that prove that God doesn't assign a gender, a sex in every situation? And once we say that, well, then can't we say that in any situation? And the reality is this. My answer to that is, again, we live in a Genesis 3 world. We live in a world where all number of things because of sin, whether it's disease or it's any number of different things that happen in our bodies, that these things can happen. Now, obviously, we want to walk gently and lovingly and specifically with a person who might be born in that way. But living in a Genesis 3 world does not mean that if someone is born a certain way physically or born with a certain proclivity towards identifying themselves as gay or transgender or whatever it is, doesn't mean that God has assigned them that way, that God has made them that way, okay? We live in a world that's impacted by sin, okay? The same way that I might be born with a proclivity towards cancer or another person might be born with a history of some other disease in their family or some other thing. But Genesis 1 show us that it's the Creator, not the culture, that sets apart what a male and a female is. Okay? Now, both are created in the image of God, right? So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. The distinction, as we've seen, the distinction is obvious. He intends there to be a difference between the two. Otherwise, he wouldn't identify it that way. So male and female, he created them. So definitions of male and female are given not by culture, but by the Creator. Now, number two, gender is defined, and I want you to see this in these verses, defined to provide order, fulfillment, and dominion. Okay? He's going to talk about male and female, both in the sense of how we've traditionally understood gender, which is the role that I play in my culture because of my biological sex. All right? He's going to talk about it that way, and he's also going to talk about it in the sense of just the purpose of your sex, period. Okay? So gender is defined to provide order, fulfillment, and dominion. Where do I get that from? Well, look at the second part of verse 26. Let us make man in our image after our likeness. Look at the purpose. And let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. Okay? So what's the purpose here? The purpose here is to provide order. Okay? Order within everything from the family, the most basic unit of culture, to man's place in the greater created realm. Okay? So it's to provide order and dominion. What does dominion mean? It means that you're there to expand that order beyond your family across all of creation. Okay? So order and dominion and fulfillment. All right? So there is to be a fulfillment that's there as well. Number three, biological differences are determined by one's determined by one's sex plays a role in one's role within creation. All right, let me. I used some language there that sounded kind of repetitive. So, what I'm saying is, God made one person a man and another person a female. Okay, and He created you biologically different, so that you would function in a certain way within a culture. That doesn't mean a narrowly defined, you must function exactly like this, but that you would play a range of functions. That doesn't mean that a woman's role is only to be in the home, a woman's role is only to be a bearer of children. I don't believe that that's the point of what he's saying here. But that a man should be, God created men generally to be a certain way. Men are generally larger and stronger and inclined towards a task in a way that makes them focus singularly, which is the frustration that many of you women feel with us, because we have a hard time taking any other thing into account when we're focused on a thing. Whereas God has made, generally speaking, women, beyond the obvious biological differences, He's made you more inclined to empathy. He's made you, in many ways, distinct from a man. I'm going to draw the line at more inclined towards empathy, because my daughter and my wife are sitting here, and I'm afraid the more I talk about the differences, the more prone I am to say something that will get me in trouble. You know what I'm talking about. Number four, sex is a recognition of one's ability to play a distinct role within procreation. So, where do I get that from? Right in the middle. Verse 28, and God blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it. Okay? Male and female plays a cultural role, as we've been seeing, but it cannot be divorced from one's sex. When we talk about one sex as being male or female, here we're talking about the role that a person plays within the act of procreation, okay? That a man has a certain role to play. I don't know if you guys remember this. Last year in the newspaper, there was an article that said, world's first pregnant man, and it was not the Weekly World News, okay? World's first pregnant man. But if you read the story further, the reality was this was a woman who had transitioned to being a man. But because the reality of her sex was that she was a woman, even though she identified as the gender of male, that we found ourselves in this situation where we would say that we've had the world's first pregnant man. When reality says, of course, that that's not the case. We talk here, and what I want you to see here is that your sex, your place within the act of procreation, cannot be divorced from your gender. Okay? When he's talking about the two things here, both your function in culture and your function in procreation, he's talking about both of those things as part of your maleness or your femaleness. Okay? So sex is a recognition of one's ability to play a distinct role within procreation. Now, what else does the Bible say about this? We talked last week, or last time, about what the Bible means when it talks about an abomination, okay? Because that's that word that has certain connotations, especially in someone's mind where they fall into one of those categories that the Bible says is an abomination to the Lord, right? And we talked about the fact that there are really two kinds of things in the Bible that are called an abomination. And it's these things that go against the very base nature of what God has defined you to be as a man and a woman, your very basic identity of who you are, and also worshiping things other than God. He calls both of those things an abomination. So Deuteronomy 22:5, Old Testament law, I want to remind you again, and if you've forgotten it, you can go back to the last session, but yes, this is an Old Testament law passage. Yes, it's hard. Yes, the Old Testament law called on things that we don't embrace today. But I want to remind you that what we talked about last session was that while Jesus said that we're no longer under the penalty of the law in the sense of the culture, the law still stands. It's still defined as sin, though he didn't embrace the Old Testament punishment of death on a person, right? But he still promotes that this definition of being sin is still valid. So Deuteronomy 22:5 is the only other place in the Bible that would deal directly with this issue, where it says, "A woman shall not wear a man's garment, nor shall a man put on a woman's cloak, for whoever does these things is an abomination to the Lord your God." I don't think here he's talking about the old Shakespeare plays where they always had, or, you know, Peter Pan, where they always have a smaller guy, or smaller, what's the word I'm looking for? A woman who looks slightly like a young boy, okay? I don't think that's what it's talking about here. But obviously, when they're writing these things, there are no hormone therapies, there are no gender reassignment surgeries. So he's talking here about a man who would choose to present himself as a woman, or a woman who would choose to present herself as a man. And what does he say about it? He says that it's an abomination before the Lord. So what we're talking about here is one sex pretending to be another. Now, why does he call it an abomination? He calls it an abomination because it is at the very core a rebellion in the heart against the very nature of what God created you to be. Okay, it's a level of rebellion that goes about as deep as that rebellion can go. All right. So I wanna end this discussion, and then I'll stop and ask for specific questions about this before I go on and deal with other questions, by reminding you of what we talked about again last session. Does that mean that this person is unable to be saved? Does that mean that a transgender person is beyond what God's salvation? And again, I just want to bring you back to this passage, 1 Corinthians 6:9-11. It says, "Or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality." Some translations will call that effeminate, because there seems to be an idea here of grouping the two things together. "Nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God." But then verse 11, "And such were some of you, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God." So the gospel says that grace is available to all, but we get there through repentance, by acknowledging sin for what it is. Which again, to come back around to this central idea, this is why we want to speak the truth in love. It's not loving to not speak the truth. You can also speak the truth in an unloving way. And so we want to be sure that we're doing that. So how should we proceed? I just want to suggest five things. And then I want to hear some thoughts from you as well. Because as I said the first session, I don't want to present myself as an expert. I'm not. Somebody asked a question about the psychology involved. I'm not a psychologist. Some of you perhaps took more psychology classes in your undergraduate degree than I did. I don't know. I don't want to present myself as the expert. We're all walking through this path together. So I'd love to hear it from you as well. But how should we proceed? Well, number one, and I think that first word is really important, that we would actively love our transgender neighbors as fellow sinners. And when I say actively, I don't just mean have warm feelings in your heart towards them. I mean that you go out and you put feet and hands to your love for them, all right? That when you encounter them at work or in your neighborhood or your grandchild or whatever it is, that there would be love in how you deal with them, that you would touch them in a loving way, that you would speak to them in a loving way, that you would respect them in the way that you talk to them. So you would actively love our transgender neighbors because they also are created in the image of God. They also are fellow sinners in need of God's grace. Number two, that you would sympathize with your transgender neighbors because I have a great deal of sympathy in my heart towards anyone who feels so disconnected. When I say because of sin, I don't mean necessarily their sin. I just mean the sin in the world, this world that we live in, that they feel so disconnected from what they are, that they would feel that they were something at their very core different from what they are. There's a great amount of sympathy in my heart towards somebody that has that level of confusion and difficulty that deep down to their very core, so that you might approach them that way. For too long, I've heard too many Christians talk about this issue with the ew factor. You know, ew, that's just gross, it's just weird. You know, and it's a distancing kind of a thing. When the reality is, these are people who, because of sin, they have a proclivity in this direction in their life. And as fellow sinners, we should hurt for them. We should hurt with them. So that we have that kind of sympathy towards them. Number three, be sure in your workplace, in your home, in your marriage, in your friendships, be sure that you're striving to model a biblical picture of what God intended a man or a woman to be. Okay? And I don't mean model the cultural standards, okay, of what's expected in America of a man or what's expected in your community of being a man or being a woman. But be sure that you're modeling. So men, we're not looking to be macho. We're looking to be that loving, tender shepherd that we're called to be, putting ourselves last in our leadership, not first. So be sure to model that for your children, for your neighbors, for your friends, for those people around you, so that they're seeing a biblical picture of what a man or a woman is supposed to be. Number four, if you have children or grandchildren or younger people that you have the ability to speak into their life, we need to talk openly about this issue. If you wait to discuss this issue with your kids until they're junior high, you're probably too late. I talk to people that work in elementary schools, people who have kids in elementary schools. This is something that they're being presented with at very young ages. You need to talk about this issue with these children in your life. I'm not saying go grab some random kid. I'm saying somebody that you have a relationship with, all right? You need to openly dialogue about these things at an age that you're not comfortable with because guess, I mean, you're never going to be comfortable. It's never going to be a comfortable topic. And they're going to be hearing it from the world around them. So we've got to talk about these things. You know, like I said at the beginning, I really, really hope that you and other people will take this material, these thoughts, these ideas, if not the videos, and talk through it with kids as young as junior high, maybe even younger, because they're encountering these things regularly. So talk openly, because where else are they going to hear about what God has to say? This is very much counterculture. This is very much offensive. This is where God's word is offensive to the culture that we live in. And we can't apologize for that. And we shouldn't apologize for that. But it's extremely countercultural, and they're not going to hear it anyplace else. So you need to talk openly to your children about these issues. Number five, and I touched on this briefly before, don't overreact when you see a child, a grandchild, who you think might be a little sissy, or you think might be a little too tomboy, or you might even find them dressing in the clothes of the opposite sex, or whatever. Don't overreact in that situation. Just pray. Just live the example in front of them of what a man is biblically, what a woman is biblically. Live that out in front of them, and trust that God is going to work on that child's heart. Because, as we keep saying, the big issue here is not the LGBT, all right? The big issue is the S-I-N, in the heart, capital S, right? The rebellion in the heart, okay? And that's true for all of us. Now, before I go on to other questions, I said we're going to spend half the time talking about this, half the time answering some of the specific questions you've already asked me. Before I go on to that, are there any questions or thoughts, ideas where you might further what I was just talking about how do we move forward? So any of those things that you would like to discuss before we sort of go out a little broader? Jerry.
It could be,
and you know, that child is also striving to form in their mind. You know, that's a big part of childhood, is trying to form in your mind, what does it mean? What does it mean for me to be a man or a woman? And sometimes that play helps them identify that, you know, and firm that up in their mind. So it could very well be. Anyone else? Any other questions or thoughts? Where's the line? Is that kind of what you're asking?
Yeah, what's defining gender roles that are outlined by someone else, and putting them as the very nature of who you are.
Yeah. What's that?
The heart.
The heart?
Yeah. If in your heart you feel like a man, you know what you're doing, but it's different than, hey, you know what, that man sure is.
Yeah, you know, it reminds me of, and I'm coming full circle, the Supreme Court years and years ago tried to define pornography. And they basically, you know, to distinguish it from, say, art or whatever, how do you define pornography? And the way they basically arrived at it was, Pornography, you know it when you see it, right? You just know it when you see it. So like you sometimes will wear one of my high school baseball jerseys, right? And that's completely fine. I can't wear it anymore. You might as well. That's completely fine because that's just, you know. But if I wore your ballet tutu, you know, everyone would understand that these are different things. And I guess that's, so is it wrong for a woman to wear a man's shirt? No, because that's kind of culturally something that happens. However, you know, is it wrong for a man to wear a woman's skirt? Well, if you're not in Scotland, probably. You know, and I'm joking a little, but I feel like I'm missing your point by the look I'm getting. So. I think it comes down to what Joe is saying, intent. What is your intent? What are you trying to present by wearing this thing? If you're trying to present that this is a comfortable shirt versus am I trying to present myself as being something that biologically I'm not? I don't know if that answers your question. I hope it helps. Anything else? All right. Let me, with what little time we have left, let me go through. I got 18 questions. No way I can tackle them all, but I did circle some, and I'll try to come back to the others. The first one that I wanted to deal with, these are all questions that you submitted to me. Is it even necessary to talk about this? Now, I'm going to assume that what that person didn't mean was, is it necessary for us to talk about this here? However, I'm going to address that. It is necessary for us to talk about it here because there's so much in the culture teaching a message that is against what God's word says. So it's necessary for us to reinforce what God's word says because it's an issue that the world is talking about so much. So people say, why is the church so obsessed with this issue? The church is not obsessed with this issue. If anything, we don't talk about these issues enough. The world around us is discussing it, so it's necessary for us to talk about it. Now, I'm assuming what they mean by, is it even necessary for us to talk about this? You mean more in an outwardly focused way, in talking to someone that's lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender. Is it even necessary for us to talk about this? Well, I would say what I said at the very beginning, which is, I'm not going to make it the big issue. I'm just not. I'm not going to lead with this. Their ultimate problem, you've probably heard me tell this story before because I tell it all the time, but when I was a youth pastor in North Carolina, I got to hang out in the public schools and talk to kids all day long if I wanted to. And there was a young man there who I talked to him and his girlfriend for the longest time. I'd meet him at school. I'd take him out for coffee. I'd talk to them. They didn't know the Lord. This kid had a different color hair every single day. And finally, I got him to attend church with me. And we had the whole old church building. This is a decent-sized church. The old original church building was all the youth building, except for we had the senior adults class in there. And the one Sunday that he visited with me, he had blue hair. And one of the elderly women in the church pulled me aside and she said, I think it's just terrible that you've brought someone with blue hair into our church. And I said, respectfully, ma'am, I don't think his blue hair is his biggest problem. And I feel the same way about this issue. So is it necessary for us to talk about this? I would say we're not going to lead with it. You shouldn't lead with it. It's not the biggest issue in what we're talking about. It's a symptom, not the disease. But that said, the culture around us is not going to allow us to ignore this issue. Some of you have experienced this. Evangelical churches are being forced to confront this issue. And some of them are buckling under the pressure, and they're not saying what God's word says because they don't want to be labeled in a certain way. The culture is not going to allow us to not talk about the issue, so we have to talk about the issue. I wish this place was packed out while we were talking about this issue. I'm thankful for the size response that we have, but it's something that we've got to talk about because all around us the world is talking about it. Another question, how should we address transgender people? I'm assuming again here that you mean, do we call them he or she? Do we call them by their chosen identity, or do we call them by their assigned identity? This is a tough question. It's a tough question, and I don't know that there is a black and white answer to give to this. The underlying issue is this. We don't want to affirm anyone in their sin. Okay? You don't want to encourage anyone to go in a sinful direction. We also don't want to cause a level of offense right up front that's going to shut that person off to me being able to share the gospel with them. So I don't know quite how to answer that question. I would not condemn a person who called a man who had transgendered, who had transitioned to being a woman. I would not condemn that person for calling him her, or referring to her as, you know, Caitlin instead of Bruce, or whatever. I don't know that I have arrived at what I think is the right situation. I think to some degree it would depend on the nature of my relationship. Is this someone that I'm close to, that knows that I love them, or is this someone that I'm just getting to know? So I think my answer would probably lie there. What's the nature of my relationship already with that person? Somebody may conclude that it's unloving and affirming someone in their sin to ever call them by that name. There's someone in our church, so I'm not going to name the person, who this issue could potentially cost them their job because of not feeling that it's okay for them to refer to a transgender person by their chosen sex and their chosen name. So I would say that this is a conscience issue and where you ask God for wisdom in knowing how to address that person. Another one, is it ever okay for Christians to attend same-sex weddings? I answer this question after the one I just answered because the answer is very similar to me. I would not, because in the United States, in our culture, your presence assumes you are there to rejoice with them. Okay, for the same way that if one of my children were living in a heterosexual relationship outside the bonds of marriage, would I allow them to come into my home? No, I would not, for the same reason that I feel that by my presence there, or that child and their significant other under my roof, that by my presence there or their presence here, I am affirming just by my presence what's going on as being a good thing. That said, that's where I've landed on that issue. I understand that some of you, this is not a hypothetical. There are people in our church that this is a real issue. But that's the question that you've got to wrestle with is, does your presence there communicate that you're affirming? Now, I feel slightly stronger about this one than the last question because there's the assumption if you're invited to that wedding that there's already a relationship there. And I pray that already there's a knowledge that you love that person so that that relationship is already there for you to be able to communicate to them that you don't approve of what they're choosing to do while you also are still someone who loves them, you know, very deeply. But again, I don't feel that that's quite a black and white, though I feel stronger about it than I did the one about how to address transgender people. Here's a question that gets to the very heart of what we're doing here. One person wrote, does it make me a sinner to love my son even though I don't agree with his lifestyle? He knows what the Bible says, and it doesn't do me any good to discuss it with him. No, I would say it'd make you a sinner if you didn't love your son. You know? And yes, if you've raised that child to understand, and this is true whether we're talking about LGBT issues or any other question of sin, if you have raised them to understand what God's will is, yes, there are times when you need to just keep your mouth shut and love them because they know what God's word says. Now, you've got to ask yourself that question, do they know? But if they know, you love them as best you can, you hold the line of what God's word says, you don't affirm them in the sin while you also love them. I think we're commanded to love that son, that child, whoever, who's going through those things. I'm scanning. One question that I got was, isn't it, and by it, I assume they mean LGBT, isn't it something you do rather than something you are? And the answer is yes to both. Because when I talk to these people and they tell me that this is their sense of who they are, I believe them. I believe that this is their sense of who they are. They are a man who is attracted to other men. They are a woman who's attracted to other women. They're somebody who feels like they're the sex opposite of the one that they were born with. So is it something you do rather than something you are? I would say it's something that you are because we live in a sinful, fallen world. And for many people, like the author of the book that I have you reading, that's something that he's going to struggle with his whole life, you know? God may choose to set a person free from these temptations and these proclivities towards sin, and he may not. You know, Paul prayed. Paul prayed three times to the Lord that he would take away whatever this undefined thorn was in his flesh. And God said, no, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power will be made perfect in your weakness. Right? So, another person asked the question, what do I think about conversion therapy? I'll just lump these things in here together. God may set that person free from that turmoil inside themselves, and he may not. The same as he may set you free from your proclivities towards certain temptations and sins, and he may not. But one thing we want to distinguish, as the book does, is that having a temptation towards a certain thing is not sin. Okay? For a person to struggle with same-sex attraction, or for a person to struggle with a sense that they feel like a woman even though their body says they're a man, that's not a sin. So is it something you are? In some senses, yes. Is it something you do? That's where it becomes sin. The same as it does when we act on any temptation, on any sin, towards any sin. Is it something you are or something you do? And the answer, I think, is both. But it's the something that you do of where it becomes sin, where it becomes something that violates God's will for you. And we talk about these issues now as though we are automatons, that's the word I'm trying to come up with, who we're just at the mercy of our bodies and our flesh, and we have no self-control and no ability to overcome, and we just must act in accordance with how we feel. That's the message in our world today. But God has not made us animals. We don't function on an instinctual level in the same way that they do. We have the ability to exercise self-control. We have the ability to resist, especially as a Christian, to resist temptation towards sin. God gives us that ability to do that. And so any more than it's acceptable for a heterosexual man to justify his philanderous nature and activities, it's not acceptable for him, and it's not acceptable for anyone else, because we do have self-control, and we're not at the mercy of our bodies to do whatever it is they tell us to do. So there you go. I don't know if that's helpful or not. Another question, is there a known percentage of people who are LGBT? I said to you earlier that the T is at most 0.4%, but if we lump them all together, the generally accepted number today is 4%. Now, The generally accepted number maybe a decade ago was 2%. So the number she has doubled, all right? So it is an increasing number, but when we talk about this, most Americans, they did a poll about what Americans thought that the LGBT population, what percentage of the population they thought they were. And is it the mean? Is that the one in the middle? The average was 25%. Americans thought that the LGBT community made up 25% of Americans, when the reality is it makes up 4%. Now, these are still 4% of our neighbors. These are still 4% of the people that we know. But estimates are about 4%. One question that touches directly on something I said tonight: how do I explain this unavoidable question to my children? How do I deal with the fact that they face it at school? I think it depends on the age of the child. I think it depends on the questions that they're asking. I think it depends on that child's maturity level. If you have a relationship with that child, if it's your child, you know where they're at, what they can handle, what they can understand. So I think there's a lot of factors that come into that. I think you have to be loving and appropriate. The first time I had the talk with my son, I didn't bring out pictures and diagrams, you know, because that was not the stage that he was at. So I think it depends on a lot of different factors. I think the important thing is that you do talk about it, because the world around you is talking about it. And we shouldn't treat sexual matters as though they're ugly or dirty or something to hide. This is something God created to be beautiful. Yes, the world can make it ugly, but we need to be able to talk about these things with our kids. So how do you explain it to them? I think, yes, it is unavoidable, and you have to talk to them. And sometimes it's okay to say, this is a hard topic that mom doesn't exactly know. I'm sorting it out with you, but here's what God's word says, and I'm trying to figure that out, and I'm trying to apply it. I think that's a great way to approach parenting, because you're communicating to your child that you exist under God's authority, right? They exist under your authority, but ultimately you both exist under God's authority. Because one day you're going to come out, they're going to come out from under that umbrella of your authority, and they're going to exist under God's authority too. So I think it's okay for you to say, here's what God's word says. And I'm still wrestling through, what does this mean? But here's what God says. And to be open and honest even about your own lack of certainty about how to deal with things. Somebody asked the question, what is the psychology behind homosexuality? I'm going to punt on that. I'm going to recommend the book, the first book that I suggested. He has a wonderful chapter on psychology of what that person is going through. Another one, does the Bible see a difference between religious and legal marriage? No, not really, because in the Old Testament, where you see these things, the religious law was the moral law. I think that we need to understand that marriage has always been first and foremost a religious ceremony. So the state of New York can define marriage however it wants to. I'm not saying I'm indifferent to that. My concern about that is only for the gay and lesbian people in our community, that our government is encouraging them down a path towards sin. My concern is not that somehow the culture is going to gobble up marriage and make my marriage meaningless. Marriage is first and foremost a religious thing, always has been. So does it see a difference between the two? No. Does New York State? Yes. That's the culture that we live in, but the Bible doesn't. How do I let the LGBT person I am conversing with know they are being heard? Terry and I talk about this a lot. She is much more naturally gifted at this than me, although I think there are a lot of people that are much less gifted at it than me. We live in a day and age where people, all of you are doing wonderfully. I've been up here talking for an hour. But we live in a day and age where people are not very good at listening. You know, they just don't listen. And you know when you're talking to someone and they give you about 15 seconds and then their eyes are elsewhere. And they're looking down or they're looking at their watch or they're, you know whether or not that person is really connected with you. And how does it make you feel? It makes you feel kind of insignificant, right? It makes you feel like this person doesn't care enough about me to give me their undivided attention. That may or may not be the case. Maybe they've got something burning on the stove, but that's how it makes you feel, you know? So how do I let them know that they're being heard? Eye contact, body language, repeat, basic communication skills, repeating back to them what they've just said. So what I'm hearing you say is this, you know? Those different things that women are inherently good at, my guess is probably one of the men wrote this question, but I'm not sure. Just basic communication skills that we all use to say to this person, I care enough about you to listen. To broaden this out in evangelistic conversations, when I have time to really sit down and talk to someone about the gospel, If let's say I have an hour, I'll spend at least the first 30 minutes just asking them questions about themselves, trying to talk about them, trying to engage about them, trying to communicate that I care about who they are enough to sit and listen to them. Now, partly because I hope I really do care about them, partly also because it's going to help me communicate the gospel to their life in a way that just sitting down, here's a tract, let me walk through the tract with you, that doesn't communicate the same thing. So how do we communicate with them in a way that lets them know they're being heard? Eye contact, listening, actively listening, all of those things. Because there's a good chance that they're going to react strongly against what God's word says. God's word is offensive when it confronts sin in a person's life. But we want to make sure that we ourselves are not being offensive. Validate their feelings. Can you define that further for me? Yeah, I think you can validate that you know what they're going through without approving of the sin. Yeah, and it's tough. It's tough. And there's been many times in talking to unbelievers that I've had to go back and apologize to them because I didn't say something when I should have, or I said something I shouldn't have. And I think God's even used that because it says to them that I care enough about them that I've been thinking about this. I think all the rest of them I have tackled. So are there any other questions about what we talked about tonight or even just general questions? We'll have one more chance at the very end of this to address any other topics that come up. Although much of the rest of what we're going to be talking about from this point on is going to be practical about how to converse with, how to talk with, how to share the gospel with people that struggle in this particular area. But are there any other questions to do with what we've been talking about so far? Skylar?
What about the new
gender neutral terms, Z and all of that kind of stuff? What about that? This is Brad Gunther speaking and not the Bible, okay? I just want to make that clear. I think it does. If somebody else feels convicted more strongly about this, that's why I said this is Brad Gunther speaking. I think it does. I mean, if this is someone I have a relationship with, I'm going to avoid using those terms. I'm going to avoid using those terms anyway. The question that she asked was, what about these gender-neutral terms? Like, I'm not even sure if everyone's familiar with them. There's a number of them, but one of them is Z instead of, like, she or he. There's Z. There's a whole list of them, um, of, approve gender-neutral terms. And people are, one of the most basic ways that people are doing it today is they're using they in a way that they has never been used before. They is being used gender-neutral instead of plural, you know? So that would be another thing. So she's asking, would you kind of lump that in with what I said before? And I'm saying I kind of would, although I'll avoid it as best I can. Any other questions? Is there anything you guys would add? Because I really struggle in walking through this, because, I know that some of you, this is a much more personal issue than it is for me at this point. Would any of you have any insight into any of these things?
From a young adult perspective, yeah. Identity is really what it's been coming down to based on what I'm seeing in my college and high school. People feel displaced and are trying to find community, because whether they come from a broken home or they are not willing to make a commitment to a friendship and they see a built-in community, kind of what we talked about in the first week. Mm-hmm. And first of that, something I've been finding.
I would love to see the Christian groups. When I say infiltrate those groups, I don't mean with a purpose other than just loving them and saying we care about you. Obviously we can't affirm sin. We've talked about that a lot. But we can love these people that are in sin, right? Well, that
I've seen people are like, oh, they're gonna tell me I'm wrong, and I'm like the worst person ever. I'm like, no, I'm.
Yeah. That really says, Skylar, that you're living out the model of Christ. You know, Jesus was often referred to by those who didn't like him as a friend of sinners, right? So that means you're living out exactly the kind of life that you should in front of these people. Yeah. Good. Joe? Absolutely. One person I consider a mentor refers to that as red apple evangelism. You know, that person in that moment where the gospel is just the opportunity is ripe right in front of you. Because there's that question, you've laid the foundation just by being a friend and loving them. Yeah, good. Yeah, any other thoughts or questions? Awesome. Why don't we close in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, I pray that as we have walked through these difficult things, Lord, I know it's a lot. I know that it's heavy. I pray that you would bless these that are here and those that have come, and that you would just use their willingness to wade into these difficult things, that it might bear fruit in their lives, that it might bear fruit in the lives of those around them, so that they would be salt and light, so that they would be, just like we talked about with Skylar a second ago, that they would look like Christ, that they might be called a friend of sinners. we might model the same approach that he would take, Lord. And so, Father, we just pray tonight that you would be glorified in our attitudes. I pray that you'd be changing our thoughts and our attitudes towards your word, towards these people, our neighbors, Lord, and that you might, through that, just enable us to be difference makers in someone's life, Lord, that is struggling in these areas. Father, I thank you so much for your word. I thank you that it does not change. I thank you for who you are, that you are a God of love, that you're a God who saves, that you reach into the darkest places, Lord, and you pull us out. So, Father, we thank you for that. We pray that you'd help us to be witnesses of that. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.